This episode of Talking Simpsons is brought to you by Bomba Socks. And you listeners can go to getbombas.com/lasertime to get 20% off your first order.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, where we're in Pizza Face Paradise. I am your host, Bob Mackey, and I've lost 5% of my brain. And this is the Laser Time Podcast Network's chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who else is here with me today?
The king of fooling, Chris Antista.
And Henry Gilbert, and I gotta say, God bless those pagans.
And today's episode is So It's Come to This, a Simpsons clip show.
Somebody made a reference to a Laser
Time
clip show.
It's not even an opening clip?
No, there's like, I barely got anything out of this.
Okay. Mm.
I thought they were insulting me when we put up a best of show for the break, and someone like, So It's Come to This. Like, come on, man, be nice!
All new, 33% new content, right?
And he was making reference to this and being nice.
I see.
And getting it, so I hope I didn't yell at him.
And today's episode, of course, aired on April 1st, 1993, the perfect time for a clip show.
Oh boy, Bobby!
Oh my God!
This week, First Lady Hillary Clinton gets the country behind broad-sweeping health care reform, David Koresh comes to his senses and agrees to cooperate with the U.S. government, River Phoenix recognizes he has a drug problem and nips at the bud with a trip to rehab, and the Super Mario Brothers movie wins an Academy Award.
Wow.
That is all April foolishness.
These are all...
April fools on all of you.
Wait a minute, these are all wacky facts.
That's right, none of that
exists. These are real facts.
The real news this week, Unforgiven wins Best Picture at the Academy Awards, Cheers tapes its last episode, and Brandon Lee, son of Bruce, is killed by a bullet blank on the set of The Crow.
That sucks. And the guy just died, Michael Massey,
the
right?
The man who killed him just died,
and
too, yes.
It burns my beans that when they obituaryized him,
oh, no.
In the headline, like, guy
You're
who
right.
killed other guy, now yeah. now dead himself, the irony.
Which is
the
not
man who killed
so not yeah. fair.
No, it's
Did
not.
You, if you,
he was a working actor, a character actor his whole life.
Yeah, like, and that
because one stunt coordinator fucked up.
Yeah, really fucked up.
Yeah.
We're messing around with the stupid gun, not realizing that blanks at that time, if you put anything in front of that, it will act like a bullet.
Yeah.
And if you're messing around with the wrong gun,
yeah.
God, it's not even one of those mistakes like, how did that happen? Oh, like this, and it
yes.
could have been avoided. This sucks.
Poor Michael yeah. Massey.
The goddamn Lee family, it sucks.
Yeah, that... I mean,
his dad and him on a set.
Crow had much more power to it and interest in it than it was just like a shitty Dimension Films mm-hmm. revenge movie. Like,
yeah.
but it takes on way more meaning, just like, you know, the music of Jeff Buckley mm-hmm. that when you know the guy died.
Yeah.
And this man died on, especially with like the magic of the Lee family curse that you imagine.
Yeah.
That there's,
it's all too convenient.
I remember in the film Dragon, a Bruce Lee's story, where they don't really want to talk about why he died, but they instead just have a dream sequence where he's being chased by death that
yeah.
kind of represents it. I believe there's a moment in there where he thinks death is coming for his son, too.
Death is played by Michael Massey.
Which is weird because his son wouldn't die yet. And also, Brandon Lee turned down playing his dad in that movie.
Oh.
Mainly because he said, I don't want to act with a woman who dresses like my mom and kisses
That is
her.
Weird.
Like,
that is pretty weird.
He wasn't into that.
Whatever.
So,
to each his own, I guess.
Clocking in at only an hour and 20 minutes. This is the shortest Talking Simpsons yet because we are doing the clip show.
Yeah.
And I have to say, in the commentary, they talk about the reasoning for this. The writers asked for this. They needed a break. Everybody is so overworked. People are leaving the show. Al Jean and Mike Reiss need like a lifesaver thrown to them, and this was that lifesaver. Basically mm-hmm. creating a third of an episode's worth of work for them, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and for the animators too. But this was, I guess, yeah, we talked about it in other ones. This is mm-hmm. a point of crisis. Like, they lost all these writers.
Yes.
And they weren't hiring too many new ones yet. They hired Oakley and Weinstein, they hoped, and hired Conan. But they had lost Jeff Martin, they lost Kogan and Walidarsky, they had lost all these people. And so John Vitti wrote this script, and
That's
he
right.
is the MVP of clip shows, mm-hmm. at least of in the first decade of the show. Every clip show was written by him.
That's true.
But his under the name of first one was Pennywise, second one was Pound Foolish.
This one he is John Vitti.
He is John Vitti.
And on the commentary they say he had to be like legally forced to write that second clip show, which is probably why it's the worst. The
love
clip
one?
Show. Yeah.
Oh my God, it is the worst
this,
one.
Man, this is a big bummer for me. Another more syndication woes. Doubling
yeah.
up down. Because I'm recording every episode of The Simpsons that ever airs. And I see the promo for this one, and it's Bart yelling April Fool's, getting blown out of the doorway and the roof flying off. I'm like, motherfucker, this is going to be the best episode ever. And for whatever reason, I couldn't be there to record it. Mm. And for whatever reason, they don't run this a lot in syndication, or definitely not as first run reruns. Mm. So I didn't get to see this for years.
Wow.
And when I did, I still couldn't see the goddamn German episode, so I thought the chocolate sequence was from this the German episode.
Well, I have to say, like, we look down on clip shows, right, of course, in our modern age where anything can be watched at any time, but in this period of time, in April of 93, seeing these clips was a delight, unless you recorded them on VHS religiously, because The Simpsons would not enter syndication, everyday syndication, until the fall of 94. Yeah. So you had 18 months before you could watch The Simpsons every day of your damn life.
Yeah, it never bothered me when I finally saw it.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. I mean, like, this was a novelty, and 15 million people still watch this clip show. That's insane. Wow. Like, I looked up of course it's 15 million, because what else were you doing on Thursday night?
And back then, clip shows were... they weren't celebrated. I do know when I was watching a syndicated show and they did a clip show, like, I still was like, groan. And they were things that you saw on every show. Every sitcom did a clip show. One of my favorites was Mary Tyler Moore's clip show, or one of them, where Mary is having one of her many failed parties at her house, and the power goes out. And so it's just a black, when they're not flashing back, it is just a black screen with the characters talking on them. And Johnny Carson visits, and it's just him talking like, hello, Mary, you invited me.
That's a good Carson, Chris.
And the joke is that Betty White's character, like, licks his face. He's like, you have a dog, Mary? Like, and then Betty White says, sorry. The joke is how little they're even working. Like, the actors didn't even have to be on set.
I had two things I read in the wiki. That's one, the print ads promoted this as the season finale, as part of the April Fool's
show. Really? It was all part of the joke,
that's
it.
Funny. Yeah, but how the fuck do you do an April Fool's joke as a print ad?
That's
I mean, when does it run? When do you run, like, just kidding?
But it works.
The episode is just kidding, I think.
The works. It is on April 1st. Like, it aired that very day.
Which apparently is Bart's birthday. According to Modern Simpsons, Modern Simpsons chronology.
Okay, Bart Schrader's telling about it here. and he celebrated his birthday last season in the Timmy O'Toole episode.
I wish I could have seen a whole episode that was just pranks.
Yeah.
Because one of the things I love about Christmas stuff is when you see all characters you know celebrating the same holiday.
Mm-hmm.
So if this is just an episode of pranks, that's my biggest bummer about it now.
Well, so they do talk about that they wanted to do this one, but they also say on this and the other commentaries for clip shows that Fox got pushier about them doing it, and they even wanted like four a season.
Why?
Well, if you're Fox and you can you'll get an episode's rights fee for syndicating The Simpsons no matter how much you spent to make that episode.
Yeah, 15 million eyes on this for half the work and half the money.
Well, no, they were thinking the long game. This is an episode they sell in syndication like any other, but it costs way less.
And I know I told that story before, being in Italy, turning the TV late at night for 2 hours. It is just Robot Chicken style, Simpsons gag, fuzz, cut to completely different Simpsons gag, fuzz, every 2 minutes. And it's great. Yeah.
And while this one is good, the best clip show is 138th Episode Spectacular.
Oh, yeah.
There's no... this one is still just like, well, this is just the greatest hits. But for 138th, they're like, we've got deleted scenes that we're going to show people. We have these good cutscenes, or we have the Tracy Ullman show clips, which we never show anywhere.
I think that's from Oakley and Weinstein, the showrunners of that time, just being big Simpsons fans and wanting to show people stuff that there were no DVDs then. I mean, there were VHS tapes, but you're not going to put deleted scenes on there.
And then they also had the host be Troy McClure, just to make it even more perfect.
So good.
I like they call it the 138th Episode Spectacular, like, perfect, underlining how pointless it is to celebrate this.
It is the greatest one. This one is... the third of it that is a new episode on this one is good. It is a good episode.
It's okay.
April Fools! I've been keeping that carton of milk next to the furnace for 6 weeks, sucker!
You're going down, Homer. I'm gonna fool you.
You talk better than you fool.
I'll fool you up real nice.
You couldn't fool your mother on the foolingest day of your life if you had an electrified fooling machine.
Damn. So it's like that, Homer.
Homer's just mean as an April Fooler. And
that's so gross.
Him ripping the duct tape off
his
your
eyes.
Apart, like, that's so painful.
Especially the giant Simpsons eyes. Yes. I feel like we see the mischievous side of Homer. That's kind of where Bart gets it, because Homer is taking an active effort into messing with Bart. Like, we don't see this side of him very often.
Well, it's weird that Bart, who is like been the ultimate prankster on the series till now, like, is getting out pranked by Homer at every turn.
He literally is taking the nuclear option in this episode.
I do love the opening dialogue.
There she blows, the catch of the day. Why, ye mutinous dogs, from this day I be requiring hair nets.
That was not even the clip I meant to play.
They have to follow health codes now. That's their punishment.
But going back to the Frying Dutchman, the second time we've been there, we won't see them again in the Frying Dutchman until the season 11 episode where Homer becomes a food critic.
Wow, long. I mean, McAllister would pop back up. I think they forget he runs a restaurant.
Yes, they just forgot it after this because he is just a sea captain. But unlike in his first appearance in the Frying Dutchman, his employees are also pirates. That wasn't the thing before, which is great. Just live with it.
I think our generation, and maybe even generations before us, have been denied the shoe polish on the telescope.
Yeah.
Just because how little we use either one.
Very few reasons.
Or kaleidoscope or any of those
things.
Or
binoculars.
Yeah, that's true. Why would you have even shoe polish?
You have to do it on an Oculus Rift.
You can use burnt cork, I suppose.
But the
pagan story. What about the pagans?
Oh,
what noble visionary thought up April Fool's Day.
Like Halloween and Christmas, April Fool's Day traces its origins to pagan ritual.
God bless those pagans.
April 1st used to be the pagan New Year.
I didn't have the whole... I love the animated sequence.
Lisa is wrong.
Why?
There's no one source for April Fool's. It's a number of things from various different cultures related to...
I mean, the Gregorian calendar did have a lot to do with it.
No, it was Jimmy Kimmel. He invented it.
Oh, God.
Giggling idiots who are untalented and sad.
But I have, like, the first known source is the Roman festival of Hilaria. So there you go. But it's many cultures.
Is that real?
It is,
yeah. Sounds like a Simpsons joke.
It's real.
When April Fool's Day is mentioned in Canterbury Tales as well. Like, it goes back that far to Chaucer. But I did like that Lisa said, like Halloween and Christmas, it goes back to pagan.
Oh, yeah.
That is
subversive,
true.
Subversive, yeah.
Which is subversive to even say, like, what TV show would say that Christmas is a pagan holiday?
But that's what America
is.
It takes defiant cultures and traditions and devours them and shits them out into their own.
Turns them into commercial paradise.
Yeah. And I did love Homer taking over the story. Like, the story takes a turn halfway through because Homer starts telling
it. I was telling the story.
Yeah.
I'd like to see the non-dream version of that tale being told. Like, Homer interrupts Lisa. Is like, and then we burn the Flanders.
I think it's a huge lame joke, but a beautiful sequence.
Yeah. I mean, the joke is no great shakes, but the animation is nice.
This is one of the only episodes I'm angry at, like, after watching it. But then it was... the last of our list. But Bart,
Homer explaining his weakness. Yeah. So Bart is looking for a way to prank Homer, and he just doesn't know how, and then the writers get just so lazy, but so funnily lazy.
Yeah.
Got to fool him before the day is out. But how? He must have a weakness.
Beer. My one weakness. My Achilles heel, if you will.
Beer! Beer is the cheese! How to
beer
use
is the
it?
Cheese.
Woo! It's a good thing that beer wasn't shaken up anymore, or I'd have looked quite the fool. An April fool, as it were.
Yeah, I love the paint mixer part. This is all part of the promo. I had to play these moments in my head for what felt like fucking years.
Hey, kid, that's for customers only!
Did you know there's a guy outside handing out free Stridex pads?
Wow, I'm in Pizza Face Paradise.
Jesus.
That line sucks.
It does.
It feels like a typical, like another Fox sitcom of this era would make.
What was the original line? Because the mouths are off. Bart sounds slightly different. Yeah. Like,
kids, Stridex.
Was the leading, right?
Still
exists. It has to.
I don't know. But I remember all that acne. I had terrible acne. All that acne stuff would work once. I
had to go to a dermatologist eventually.
And then you take Accutane, bro.
Oh, bro, Accutane, bro.
I have no night vision. It's awesome.
Oh, we're going to have clinical depression for the rest of our lives.
that the case?
Yeah, but it's like small medicated pads that would just burn you horribly.
Yeah, like soaked with alcohol, pretty much just alcohol.
Yeah.
That worked for a little while until your body builds up an immunity because you're pretty much your body's getting rid of toxins during puberty. Mm-hmm. I don't know where Accutane funneled all that.
This sounds like a tall tale Simpsons nerds covered in acne. I don't believe it.
And that paint mixer was inspired by Al Jean's dad owns a hardware store. That's how he grew up working at that hardware store.
I think his dad just passed away recently and he still owned the hardware store. Maybe like 2013. Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, that's where the paint mixer comes from. And it is pretty great. And then meanwhile, Mike Reese, I think, credited his dad for the beer PSA.
That's
the,
right.
Which is great because I like to recognize when I have bad Homer instincts and something about being defiantly unhealthy. Like, I would always smoke cigarettes when I smoke cigarettes and not vape delicious vape.
Yeah.
I would smoke cigarettes after Truth commercials to be defiant. I went and saw the movie
Dennis Leary.
I went and saw the movie Supersize Me and immediately went to McDonald's. Like, going in as someone who had not been there in years, it's like, yeah, I gotta do it. And like Bart, I love all the techniques he tries to make.
Well, then Homer resists.
Homer thirsty.
Like, he's just like, yeah, but what are you gonna do? So thirsty, but he just ignores
eating
it.
Pretzels, cranking up the heat, and then this is the topper.
The following is a public service announcement. Excess of alcohol consumption can cause liver damage and cancer of the rectum.
Beer.
Yes. So there was a big fight about that line between the writers and not the broadcast standards people. No, actually, not the advertisers, but the broadcast standards people where they're like, okay, if you want to say this, you need to prove this is true. And they did. But then
this is before the internet here, so they had to get up a medical book.
But then there was this, there was Duff Gardens, there's many Duff things. They're like, guys, just lay off beer. They advertise. Just don't do it anymore. So there was pressure.
That's Mike Reese says it many times on the commentary of like, you can make fun of smoking all day long because no cigarette company is going to pay for a commercial on TV. Mm. Beer companies, though, they're worth millions, and your executives do not like making fun of that.
So we might not see a whole lot of, I guess we do have Beer Kills Brain Cells, like some stuff like that in later episodes. I guess they wouldn't back away from it.
But they also still make drinking look awesome, too. Yeah. Like Homer just drinks
but I don't remember. I don't personally remember a lot of, I think they knew who was watching The Simpsons, and there weren't a lot of beer commercials. Mm. I think they left those for the children audience. I don't remember because I had some of those tapes and I watched it over and over again. I don't recall a lot of beer commercials.
Yeah, the only I remember drink commercial, but it was Pepsi. So the explosion of beer.
Dude, so good.
Yeah. Bart should be dead.
That sounded like an explosion at the old Simpson place.
Forget it. That's two blocks away.
Looks like there's beer coming out of the chimney.
I am proceeding on foot, calling a code 8.
We need pretzels. Repeat, pretzels.
Almost great.
So we never see the Simpsons house, but it must be just decimated after this.
That
just like ripped asunder.
The roof off of it. There's no more roof to the place.
The Simpsons wiki points out that shot of the house is all wrong. If you look very closely at it. So maybe it's a separate house. But again, like this, more so than the Halloween episodes, this has to be out of continuity.
Yeah, that kind of destruction on the house has never been happening before in the show. I mean, the house was like listing because of the bad foundation, but it's never been exploded like this.
Never been exploded. It was how the atomic bomb is shown in film.
Yeah.
Like an atomic bomb going off.
From one beer.
And then Homer, Homer is crippled by this. Bart is fine. There's no... Yeah. And also that you don't... Like, it just... This is where it feels lazy. That they're like, well, we don't want to draw the destroyed house, so we're just going to start at the hospital next and just, Bart's fine, don't think about it, and Homer's in a coma. Like, who cares?
They spend the rest of the show just like in one room almost.
They did.
Just one room.
That's also how it feels like a cheap sitcom. They're like, we made one set. We didn't even make it. We just borrowed the hospital set from a different show, and Homer's just going to sit there. And, I mean, maybe they are just reusing the design of the hospital previous episodes this season.
From Bypass, I think it is.
And character. But so many things like that, what you just said, that reminded me of other shows, including Dr. Hibbert and the connection to Ian Roberts' character on Arrested Development.
Oh, yes.
Mrs. Simpson, I'm afraid your husband is dead. April Fool's. He's very much alive, although I'm afraid he may never walk again.
I love that character. He's going to be all right. Oh, thank God.
The Simpsons will be right back.
Thank you for listening, good people. Are you warm enough? How are your feet? Ooh, this episode is brought to you by Bombas, baby. Bombas, a sock that has been carefully crafted to improve on years of sock complacency. The Bombas people spent 2 years in research and dev in order to give you a better sock at a better price. Who wants to think about getting socks? I know mine are covered with holes and I have to throw them out on too regular a basis. But the Bombas socks have advanced blister protection for your heels and a technology for helping socks stay up so you can avoid those creepy Run and Simpy sock guard. Even better, for every pair you buy, one pair is donated to the homeless. And that's a good thing because socks are the most requested items at homeless shelters nowadays. Bombas offers you 100% customer satisfaction guarantee, and should you have any problem, Bombas will send you new socks or provide you with a full refund. Hey, maybe you'd like to get started right now and get 20% off your first order, and you can do that by going to getbombas.com/lasertime. Once again, that's getbombas.com/lasertime to get 20% off your first order.
Are you already tired of 2016? Jump into the past with 302010, our weekly pop culture time machine podcast. Here's something you may remember from 1996.
July 14th, Fox rerun Why Planes Go Down, featuring a famous narrator.
Hello, I'm Gillian Anderson. I have to tell you, at first I was a little hesitant about hosting this program because I tend to be a nervous flyer. But we hope that the information in this hour will forever change the way that you travel on commercial aircraft.
What are you going to do?
This is the period where Fox was definitely like, he thought he could get away from the long arm of the law.
This guy thought he could steal a lawnmower and get away with it. Now he's mowing lawns on Rikers Island.
Well, also the whole, like, magician secrets revealed.
Yeah. He could invade Poland.
With Mitch Pileggi. Like, they got two different X-Files people.
When I watched that for the first time, she's like, at first I was hesitant. I was like, because you're Gillian Anderson and you're better than this? But no, it's because she's scared of flying.
I like the music behind it. It's so tense.
This looks like sub-PS1 level polygons in this.
This spine-chilling recording.
There's an airplane that looks like the gummy ship from Kingdom Hearts.
Our pilots being rushed to takeoff before they're ready.
Oh, it's like several triangles, I promise.
That's 302010, a weekly look at what happened in pop culture 30 years ago, 20 years ago, and 10 years ago, every Thursday right here on the Laser Time Network.
302010! So to start off our... I know we don't have all the clips counted,
No.
We're not that
almost
crazy,
none.
But like... It's so weird. So I counted the clips and clip packages. So I counted a clip as when a character announces a clip and a clip or clips start. There are 17 instances of this.
Whoa.
And the first one is just like, aren't you the veterinarian? And it's like, yes, I am. And there's like a clip.
Well, that happens late because I was watching it. Like, they're not going to acknowledge this guy's a vet. And of course they do to throw to his clip.
As a kid, I immediately recognized the vet. That's the vet. Like, I knew it. And
I was we were being introduced to so many new characters all the time.
I will give them credit for the first clips. They build the scene around it.
Yeah.
They're like, well, this is about Homer's injury, so we get to cut to all the times he's
been
injured.
Yeah, like this one.
Gently down the stream.
Homie!
Marge!
Homer has many, many horrible problems. These shadows are brain lesions resulting from numerous blows to the head.
And it cuts to a bunch of headshots to Homer.
We have to assume this doctor graduated from Mexican med school because he couldn't before.
And the first clip is the baseball hitting him. It's actually two baseballs hitting him in a row. Yeah. First, the one from Bowling for Love or whatever, Spare. Season one episode with Jacques.
Life on the Fast Lane.
Ah, thank there we you. Go. Yeah, and then it's just him getting hit in the head, and that's, as a kid, I didn't know it was a clip show. I didn't read TV Guide. So once the first clip came, I was like, huh, and I know I just had this creeping dread of like, I didn't like that it was a clip show as a kid, because I was watching all the tapes.
Same here.
I didn't care.
I feel like the writers are just picking their favorite stuff, because based on the commentaries, you can see like the next clip is the No Disgrace Like Home shocking scene, which they play out in its mostly entirety. Mm-hmm. And the next clip is something they love. I think it's still their favorite. It's Homer falling down the cliff.
Yeah.
But they add animation.
So like... kind of cuts off there in the original. More and more.
And his bloody damage, yeah.
out!
Skateboarding in the back of the head. So, yeah. Like, this was really confusing growing up when you went back to go watch Bart the Daredevil and, like, there's like two payoffs we're missing here.
Yeah, so in the original episode, the second time he falls, we only hear it.
He does fall, but you only hear it.
Yeah, and we don't see the gurney smashing his head into the ground. Yeah,
which would kill him. Like, yeah. He is dead then.
He should be dead to begin with, but they make it even more painful. It's great that they added animation to it, but it does fuck with your brain.
So they did add animation to it.
Yeah,
they did.
I couldn't remember if there was a story where it was cut out for being too cruel.
No,
Bart the Daredevil,
we see him fall once. The second time he falls, we only hear it.
Yeah.
This time they show the second fall. They animate new animation.
They reanimate it.
No, they make new animation. There's no reanimating.
Yeah,
of
that
it.
Was yeah. a film Roman one. You can tell if you look, you can tell it's not from the same production.
Exactly.
Time.
Yeah.
And that Homer is not a season two Homer who's getting smashed up in the second fall.
I just compared this to Arrested Development. This is so motherfucking goddamn Family Guy, especially with that, like, Homer at near death and broken.
Yeah.
You guys must have been pretty worried about me.
Hey, we know you're tough, Dad. Remember that time you got lost in the forest?
I've never seen such an unironic Family Guy movie.
Yeah.
If they animated a new scene, that'd be another thing. But yeah, so they put all that work into the first scene of, like, laying it out that we're going to remember all these injuries, and then we're going to point out that you're the vet so we can flash back to the vet scene, and then even pay off with a joke of, I can even spay and neuter Homer.
Yeah.
You're a veterinarian?
That's right. And for an extra $20, I'll give Homer a tick bath and then spay him.
Here you go, Doc.
Bart!
Shop around. You can't beat that price.
It's a pretty good deal.
Oh,
so that all pays off, but then after that, they're like, well, you remember that time? Remember that time?
So the scene after the we get the call back to the Call of the Simpsons trapping the bunny scene, we have Marge saying, remember how cool you are under pressure? And it's unfair that they have the alien abduction
that
scene.
That pissed me off as a kid, and it pisses me off now.
Well, like, now you got to know, Kang and Kodos are part of the main continuity.
I think it is cheap to flash back to a Halloween episode. And also, like, that's no great scene anyway. Like, it's not that awesome.
It's one of the many things that I think undoes a lot of fun Simpsons continuity.
Yeah, and also that scene is, like, if you are a new viewer to The Simpsons or you haven't watched every single episode, then you're left thinking they got kidnapped by aliens on this show.
This show is batshit insane. And,
I really didn't like that. And also, just to show that zoom in on the green Lisa again, like, they should never show that. That's one of the ugliest shots
hideous.
In the series.
But it's around this time in the episode that Bart realizes he's in a clip show and it starts to take advantage
that's,
of it.
And that's, I love this show.
This is
and there's one itchy and scratchy cartoon I don't think we'll ever forget.
Why'd you bring that up?
It was an amazing episode of our lives.
And it would be just to reference another comedy show probably influenced by The Simpsons, Clerks.
Yeah.
Clerks has the best clip show parody ever.
The greatest.
Those poor motherfuckers.
They got so screwed.
They got so
They were set up to fail.
The first episode airs, it's a pilot, it's fine. The second episode airs, and it is a clip show, and all they have... The second episode is a clip show, which flashes back to the first over and over again.
Yeah.
And ABC...
They air the fourth episode first.
They aired it out of order.
And then the second episode second.
Ruin the joke.
So the reference to, why are we walking like
that,
this doesn't work.
That joke probably cost them $1 million. Yes. And fuck, they wasted it.
What does ABC care?
They ruined it.
They were rolling in Who Wants to Be a Millionaire money.
And they only had 12 million viewers, those losers. I'm just guessing, but it's probably up there.
Remember they had that, remember?
That time, Dante, we were climbing that building?
they had a Super Bowl ad, which was just like Jay hitting a firecracker with a baseball bat. That was it. That was in the Super Bowl. Mm. And Kevin Smith thought, like, well, my show's definitely going to be a success. And then the Super Bowl. Bart inserting an itchy and scratchy episode was a funny.
It's funny.
I did like that.
But it's one of the only times they're being very clear about what they're doing.
I wish there was more of this Bart, like this meta Bart stuff.
Yeah, where maybe realizes where he is, so we can at least be told this is not a real show.
Yeah,
Grandpa comes close.
Before that, when they visit him with the beers, when Moe and Barney visit him with the beers. First off, Homer has like a fear of beer, a PTSD of beer, which is like for that one moment, and then you just forget it.
Mm-hmm.
They forget they even have that.
The second time Moe comes to visit him in the hospital and brings him a beer with Barney
in
this season.
Yeah, and then second, I was sure confused as a kid because I'd never seen one flew over the cuckoo's nest. That's a really lengthy scene of, as far as I knew, Barney kills Homer and then smashes a window for some reason.
He really needs a girlfriend.
That is the exact ending in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. If you haven't seen it yet,
it's great.
With Barney in a great spot, like he's a great fill-in for the chief.
I agree. He's like giant and hulking.
Eventually shows up on The Simpsons.
Well, he was previously
about time someone reached out to me. Yeah.
But I love Grandpa's line. He's my favorite part of this whole thing.
Poor Homer. This world was never meant for one as beautiful as you.
Ah! Kill it! Kill it!
Grandpa, please. He's in a coma.
Coma? Why, I go in and out of comas all the...
That's right, because Homer's only in the coma because of the candy machine.
I actually have a link to that one, as beautiful as you.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
It is a reference to a specific song, a line from a specific song that they just like, they joke on the commentary. They just have clip show. They're a clip show of songs. Like, they just have a line. So this is the Don McLean song, Vincent.
Don McLean is another song?
It's a song, Vincent, about how much he loves Vincent Van Gogh and Starry Night, and about how awesome Vincent Van Gogh is, and why it's sad that Vincent Van Gogh killed himself. And so this is the song here.
For they could not love you, but still your love was true. And when no hope was left in sight on that starry, starry night, you took your life as lovers often do. But I could have told you, Vincent, this world was never meant for one as beautiful.
Wow. You didn't know it was to Vincent Van Gogh. You think it's just like him. He's just in love with this guy who kills himself.
So I'm familiar with the song, and this is a very personal reference. But I played a prank on a friend of mine maybe 8 years ago, where on Facebook he was doing like MS Paint portraits of people. Mm-hmm. He would just take their image of them on Facebook and draw an MS Paint picture. I stitched them all together with pictures of him in like Windows Movie Maker and pretended he was a special person who recently died. And then I put like I put his name and then like not like 1979 to like 2005. We love
to
you
Starry
and miss
Night?
You. Yeah, to Starry
oh,
Night.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Sorry, I buried the lead there. And it's still online. And he's like, I can't get jobs because of this, Bob. Take it down. I'm like, nope. It's still funny.
My potential employer thinks I'm dead. I had to say my best prank because it carried over into at least when Henry knew me.
Oh, this is all relevant. I forgot this is a prank episode.
Yeah, like my best prank ever. I, for some reason, fell in love with that Raffi song, Banana Phone.
Oh, yeah.
Just hysterical. So my friend went out of town, and he always listened like just through his... We go over to their house all the time, lots of land stuff and Halo crap and like... hang around drinking with guys. We're 20. And he has just plays Under the Bridge like 800 times in a row. And I was just hating his music. So I found out how many files of music he had in his Winamp. and I copied that many. And I copy-pasted by hand every piece of song information into 100, like 300 versions of Banana Phone.
Oh,
I changed his
God.
Background to a picture of a Banana Phone.
Oh, my God.
And so he would go home, open his computer, see a different background, immediately load up his music like he always did, and like every... My Chili Peppers, my 311, they're all Banana Phone! And I'm like, I'm hoping that... like
Banana
so
Phone
like,
everywhere!
I want him to know because I'm going to hide his music from him. I didn't delete it. And like, so call me. So what I did is I set up on my answering machine message, ring, 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 banana phone, just to like really drive home the prank when he finally calls to yell at me, which he did. And it worked. And then I forgot and just left it for years. And so when I moved out to San Francisco,
that's
people would call me with jobs or like they'd hear banana phone on my answering machine. Like, that was awesome. And people was like, oh, I didn't know you were going to pick up. Just let it go to the answering machine. I want to hear Banana Phone. I'm like, hear Banana Phone.
Ruining lives is hilarious.
The second hit clip of Grandpa's coma is also great.
French toast, please.
Is the coma painful?
Oh, heck no. You relive long lost summers, kiss girls from high school. It's like one of those TV shows where they show a bunch of clips from old episodes.
Yeah, well, anyway... I wonder what he's thinking now.
Another moment where Bart is, he knows he's in a show. He's like, anyway.
Yeah.
I wonder what he's thinking now.
I feel like he was reprimanded off screen. Like, Bart, we need to show nice clips now.
Yes, that Bart doesn't care.
And we have...
Bart is an actor. We're skipping over why Homer is in a coma from not being in one. He couldn't walk. Not explained why. They don't explain if it's physical or mental. And why Homer is able to walk again is like, well, so is his spine damaged or not? Like, why can't he walk? And then he just is able to walk when he sees candy. Mm-hmm. And then I'm guessing he choked on candy so much that that then put him in a coma.
They cut off his air supply.
If he has
or something.
A nut allergy, it's the only reason he makes it, because he just says nuts in his dying breath.
So he goes from paralyzed to being in a coma, but we missed a great scene before that with Marge with a great line, which on the commentary, they're like, this is a bad joke, but it feels like a very season 2 line where Homer is like, what if I ended up, you know, just a couch potato? All I do is watch TV and drink beer. And he's like, society's loss, I suppose.
My great work will never be complete.
That's right.
Society's
yeah.
loss, I suppose.
And it's so low key, and they let it sit, but I like that line a lot.
Yeah, and then it goes straight into, I think, the worst setup for a clip ever, which is, but our marriage is always pulled through. And then when they cut to the officer and gentleman scene, it was the music, so I'm like, did they have to re-license
the
music?
That was not
clip?
The actual music, though. That was a sound-alike. It's always been that, yeah.
Because you pointed out to me, they added more animation to Bart the Daredevil, but to the Slumberland scene, the sequence for for the 6th, 7th level in the arcade.
The scene, it's a scene from Lisa's Pony. Mm-hmm. In the original broadcast version, they license the song, the Beatles song, Golden Slumbers.
I never would have recognized that. Why did you bother?
as Al Jean said it, when he was licensing it and paying a shitload of money, they thought they were getting the Beatles master. But instead, they were getting the songwriting rights so they could do an instrumental cover, which you can barely even tell is Golden Slumbers.
Can
anyway.
You imagine hearing Golden Slumbers on that episode? Like, the actual version?
That'd
be so mind-blowing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But
it's like, the part I remember is the beginning, which is the same. The Princess Bride. I can't really tell the difference.
It's way different.
I had to play them. It's actually a really good sound alike because you can't. Also, because the dun 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 dun. That it's very overbearing on the Golden Slumbers tune.
Yeah, like the strings that are backing it are very, very, very similar.
Yeah, so I actually perfectly synced it up on my computer with the YouTube of the original one with my TV playing the other one and just hit play at the same time. And it's still really, it's close to imperceptible, but...
But you can't sing Golden Slumbers to that. You'll
no
fuck
way,
it up.
Yeah.
yeah. That's how I tested. I'm like, wait a minute, you can't do this.
Mm-hmm. But
thanks, shitty Beatles.
Yes,
it's not just a clever name.
Like they were gonna call they were gonna pay the Beatles again to use that song in the clip show. The clip show is supposed to be cheap,
but they had to pay him again for the DVD release, suckers.
Yeah, and it's $5,000 a day. Sounds like not. That sounds too reasonable by today's medical standards.
Yeah, that's like, Jesus, like if you're hospitalized for a slight cough.
We're keeping you overnight, $5,000. But Burns, it's funny that in the previous episode it was all about health insurance.
Now
in this one, Burns is mad about health insurance.
But come on, the last episode was maybe the end. Burns doesn't recognize Homer. This is Burns coming for Homer, remembering everything. It is ruining
true.
The joke.
You're right.
It is
he
ruining the joke.
He remembers who he is.
It's probably like this guy who works at your plant is in this room at this hospital, and that's what the information
he makes very specific references to knowing who Homer is.
Oh, really? Okay, I didn't write that down.
He causes the flashback.
After in our view, a lifetime of never remembering Homer, and more than anything, more than the Kang and Kodos, this isn't continuity now. This doesn't matter.
What is the Mr. Burns clip they play? I forget.
So he says, well, do you have the whole thing? Or?
This man is costing my health plan $5,000 a day. I demand that he die with dignity.
Okay. Now look, I'm the doctor here.
Well, I demand a second opinion.
Hi, everybody!
Hi, Dr. Nick!
Oh, dear. I see no signs of life.
That's funny.
Just to be safe, we better pull the plug.
Huh.
Yoink!
Mr. Burns, how can you be so cold-hearted?
You have no idea, woman, what that man's put me through.
So he remembers
everything. Still calling Homer, but... That's 3 for 3 yoinks. 3 episodes in a row, 3 yoinks.
They get in these roles, I
think.
That
is a funny little scene, though it also looks like cheaply staged, where like the way Nick walks into the shot, like they're like, we're not animating a different setup, so Nick's just going to stand there, make no, like, basically look at the camera.
Yeah, like no different background drawing.
He hits him with that little, angle. medical Cro-Magnon hammer.
Yes, for the reflex hammer.
But I'd like
hammer.
To point out that this is the first and maybe only time all three notable Simpsons doctors are in the single room together.
And so then also Burns' flashback is Homer asking for money for his dog and getting pulled out of the room, which Burns at this point could have remembered a lot of scenes where Homer actually did do something bad to Burns.
And maybe Burns was funnier.
But is the joke that Burns is remembering something that wasn't even a slight?
Like, I think they just thought that joke was funny or that scene was
funny.
Yeah,
but it doesn't fit for what Burns is talking about. Yeah. It's a bad clip.
And the only clips I gathered from the show, other than the sound effects of Homer falling down, the Springfield Gorge, just the dough montage, because it's just wonderful.
I know that I got you mad once in a while.
I wanted it, like, if we were really being way more nerdy about this than we already are, like, how many of those were the same does?
That angered me.
I
was furious.
As a kid, I didn't like that either. Like, these aren't, there's like three same does.
As
in
a
here.
Kid, this, you noticed too many things, Henry.
I
Chris,
did.
Why are we podcasting right now?
It took me forever in research and
I did not like
a lifetime of loneliness to rediscover all this
stuff. So, Homer eventually wakes up with a scene that angers Matt Groening to no end.
Yeah.
And do you have that, Chris?
I do.
Okay.
The first person chokery?
Yeah.
Dad, it's all my fault. I shook up that can of beer. It was just an April Fool's joke.
Are you little?
Homie, you're all right.
We're a family again.
Still joking. There's a great bit of tension on this episode between Groening and the rest of the writers. He was like, now, when I said Homer can strangle Bart, I had some ground rules.
Yes.
A had to be impulsive, and B, it could not be sustained. And Al Jean's like, this isn't sustained. And he's like, he's still strangling Bart on the screen for like 12 seconds at least.
The family doesn't care.
Yeah.
And then it is Homer being like, it is impulsive, I guess. Like, it is the impulse that brings Homer back to life. But it was... It's really cruel. And it's first person choking.
That's a little extreme, yeah.
And it's also very cartoony. The heart rate that's Bart's head. And
yeah, that was cute.
But yeah, and right before that, the Fantastic Voyage joke. It was cute.
Going into Homer's ass.
Going through his colon, and they're just like, yeah, this... Frank implies he could do this, just people don't want to go in his colon. Like, that's the only thing.
He invented the debigulator, right?
That's
But not the rebigulator.
Some sort of rebigulator.
Rebigulator.
And that the Treehouse of Horror... Well, actually, no. It was not Professor Frank. It was his equivalent in the Tooth universe who did it. Not exactly.
I'm going to fire myself for that blunder.
Oh, and also, they did a straight... Fantastic Voyage parody in Treehouse of Horror 15.
I have seen that.
Where Marge, there's a joke about Marge's boobs that said the costume makes it a fantastic voyage.
Oh, God.
Yeah, Homer, they also have so many scenes from the Blowfish episode, too. Yeah, the dough montage.
It's one of the best, but it also punctuates that, like, there's been two episodes, Triple Bypass and One Fish Blowfish. Mm-hmm. Where you are concerned about Homer's health. And
that's true.
They try and play it up, I think, not very well in this episode. But again, it's a vessel for clips,
it's
not
a little
hard.
Cheap.
They don't really care.
Yeah.
And the Dell montage was at least like new editing. And it was apparently what David Silverman was touring around colleges with to show off. Like, he had already cut that together and was showing it when he would
just
do...
Just the Dell montage?
Yeah, just the Dell montage. Yeah. And so that's why they were reusing it, too. And now I bet they could do like a 30-minute dough montage of just every actual dough. No repeats.
But if they allowed it, it'd be on YouTube right now.
Yeah, that's true.
But I do love and the ending, but again, it's the same as the
I've
last
got some,
episode.
There's some fudged math here.
Sustain laughing.
Calls for a celebration. We're all going to Hawaii. Gotcha. It's April Fool's for two more minutes.
Dad, it's May 16th. You were in that coma for 7 weeks. Uh-huh. You lost 5% of your brain.
Me lose brain? Uh-oh. Why I laugh?
Why I laugh?
That's like the best last line of like almost any Simpsons episode.
Well, what is the fudge math,
the
Henry?
The fudge math is, they get seven weeks.
Oh, God.
They say April Fool's Day was when the house explodes. So if it's in 7 weeks after that is May 16th. Mm-hmm. So the math goes up, is correct there. They say he was in the coma for 7 weeks.
Oh.
So unless he was in that wheelchair for one day before then going into the coma.
Maybe that was it.
But then, no, they imply like lengthy physical therapy.
That's true. Just that's
him,
true.
Like,
yeah.
He's in his bed and they visit him. Like he's in the hospital for seemingly a good few, I would say at least a week. Like, yeah. You could say at least a week was spent.
He was
there,
in the hospital for 7 weeks.
You're right, Henry. On those grounds, I think this should be relegated to a DVD special feature and not a real episode. It should be one of those Looney Tunes from the vault things they don't bother to remaster but include on the disc anyway.
And Whoopi Goldberg tells you why it's offensive.
Or let her malt
it. Cheaper,
preferably.
Yeah. And
so I was watching their Tom and Jerry set.
So I did reconfirm this because I thought I'd remembered this. A few years ago, a Redditor put up one of those classic episode theories, like for this episode.
Oh, God.
Comedy writers theorize Homer's been dead the whole time.
Yes, it is that, but it has an extra spin to it. Yes, Homer dies in this episode, and every episode after this is wackier because it's just a dream sequence while he's in a coma. Which, if you have a new theory about a TV show that's all a Jacob's Ladder, somebody's dream thing, fuck right off. It's for everybody does yeah. that. I don't need that new one. But why I like this one
okay.
is because he points out that 6 months before this episode mm-hmm. was Homer the Heretic, where God says, you can't wait 6 months. So at the very least, he's got a little extra to fit in with that. But to say the show gets wackier after this one ignores Monorail and Last Exit to Springfield, which are hella wacky before Homer's death in this episode.
Now, wait, what religion tells you that the afterlife is you continuing to live your life only funnier?
Yeah,
like, for another 28 years.
I think Episcopalians.
I see.
But as far as I know,
I at least like that they say the 6 months thing fits with it. But like, look, it's a clip show. There's
I was going to say, I mean, I'll never watch it again unless I have to do another podcast.
I got 40 minutes out of the clip show.
Henry guessed that, and he was right. I have to ask, like, do any classic lines come out of this show? I don't think so.
Yeah,
like, not even one classic quote comes out of this show.
No.
I mean, Fool in a Day in a Fooling Machine, that's a...
I hear that occasionally, I guess.
Or Now Who's Laughing, but yeah, even something people actually repeat, like, doesn't really happen.
Oh, yeah, and I forgot about one reference. It's not even a joke. It just kind of shows how lazy they're being, or overworked, rather. Like, when Bart is turning up the thermostat to heat up the house to get Homer thirsty, Homer's Leo Sayer record melts. And there's no joke there. He sung the song, I make me feel like dancing or whatever.
I didn't know who that was, but I just thought it was going back to, like, Homer's taste in music is all terrible and slightly novelty-like.
Yeah, no, You Make Me Feel Like Dancing. He sung that with Barney in The Way We Was, I think. Mm. Yeah.
Oh.
That's right. Yeah. No.
Thinking of future episode?
He sings that in Homerpalooza in the flashback there.
Oh, okay.
Like, we were rocking all night and partying every day, and they're singing that one, and that's when I used to know what it is speech comes right after
he
that.
He was so cool with that Leo Sayer album. Yes. So, go ahead, sorry.
Like, this is nobody's favorite episode. It's not, it's a weak episode. It's just, it is a clip show. And
hey,
even
it's not Talking Simpsons' fault. It's the Simpsons' fault.
And Bart is the laziness of the writers, too. Just like, look, let's just set up the next clip.
I bet everyone who listened to this looked at their podcast players and said, 40 minutes? Has the world gone topsy-turvy? Because only we could do this. Now we're at, like, 46 on our timer, probably 50-something for you. But, Jesus, anything else to add? I mean, like, I will never watch this again unless I'm forced to, but I feel like this gave the writers, it stopped the writers from killing themselves or having the show kill them, and for that I am grateful.
If this made Cape Fear or Krusty Gets Canceled a better episode because they had that time, then cool. And I think when I watched this on my VHS's back as a kid, I would fast forward through the second half. I'd watch the first half, and I'd be like, I'm not watching the second half.
Yeah, and other clip shows are much worse. 138th Spectacular is good. Another Simpsons clip show is awful.
It's the worst episode of the series pre-Kid Rock.
I think you're right. And All Singing, All Dancing is okay. At least you get all the good songs.
At least it's a clip show of great songs. Like, and they mock... They put the episode title in the episode, and they mock that they're doing their fourth clip show, and they at least like mock that Snake keeps coming back in to point his gun at them over and over again.
And we have the great Paint Your Wagon parody, which is amazing. But also, the last one I think is Gump Roast, which is awful too.
Boo!
Listen, guys, 2002, it's a little too late for your Forrest Gump jokes. Yeah. I mean... I know you thought it was funny. It was in somebody's spec script for 8 years, but just get rid of that.
Yeah,
that's
that.
My lesson for today.
I think that's a Dan Castellaneta one, isn't it?
I think it's what, like, we'll throw you a bone. Like, either you or your wife can write an episode.
Ugh, that episode sucks.
It's awful.
Yeah, boo.
Yes, and
I didn't like in that episode that Bart and Lisa refer to Homer as a meanie. I was just like, they don't talk like kids.
A meanie? Weird. I forget about that episode completely.
It's
but,
really not ugh. Good.
No wonder. I've only seen it once. Thank you so much for listening to this episode. We made a lot of hay out of this clip show, dear God.
I do think we need to skip the love one, or that one's just going to be 20 minutes. Like, there really is nothing
we
to
We need to do
one.
Every one, but it will be, like, a short one.
I think if the writers do commentary on it, we got to do it.
Their commentary on that episode is... them ignoring the episode completely. They're like, we hated doing this. We were forced to do it. We're going to explain to you how we make an episode.
And that episode at least has a sick-ass burn on Ren and Stimpy. That is amazing. Yeah. And I want to at least talk about that. So, yes, I guess to wrap things up, I've been your host, Bob Mackey. Find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. I have not heard Wild Bob Mackey in so long. I forget what
computer.
It sounds like.
I keep forgetting to drag the file
You need
over.
To give me that file.
I'll do it.
But you can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. I also host the classic gaming podcast, Retronauts, every Monday at retronauts.com. Or usgamer.net, and I write every other week for Something Awful and every goddamn day for fandom.com. Read my listicles, folks. They're entertaining and informative.
Mm-hmm. And I am Henry Gilbert. That's H-E-N-E-R-E-Y-G on Twitter. Follow me for all my thoughts on the end of the world, but also you can go to
Spider-Man trailers.
And the Spider-Man trailer, the home for my thoughts on that Homecoming trailer. Pretty great, folks. Follow my work on fandom.com as well. I work with Bob over there. And you should know that this and every other bit of the LaserTime Network is brought to you by patreon.com/LaserTime. Mm-hmm. I've got a full-time job, so I don't profit from it, but the rest of the guys need your money. They need it, guys, to pay to keep this all going. And for $5 a month, you can get access to a treasure trove of amazing extras, including the entire first season of Talking Simpsons, as well as the season 2, 3, and 4 wrap-up episodes, and a bunch of other great, great things.
LaserTimePodcast.com is where all this stuff lives, including a bunch of other shows, including Laser Time, the show that started it all, topic-based pop culture rant that's had these guys on several times. 302010, the weekly look back to that week in pop culture history.
And it's a happy new year, so it's going to be a new year of that, too.
Yeah, I forget what we're doing. Oh,
this
God.
Is January 3rd.
Oh, God, I'm so tired. And then patreon.com/lasertime is home to the exclusive bonus time show where we catch you up on all the new fun stuff that we're doing. And there should be a best of episode up from Laser Time about bonus time. I'm too tired to explain. Just trust me and go to the website.
That's it for us this week. Happy New Year, everybody. Thanks for listening. We'll be back next week with The Front. See you then.
Woo!
Infotainment.